All right, so today is Monday, June 6, 2022. My name is Emily Ma, and I'm here with Ms. Tam Le for the Houston Asian American Archive at Rice. So to start from the very beginning, could you tell us where and when you were born?
Yeah, I was born in Houston, Texas, August 12, 1989, at what was Herman Hospital at the time.
And how would you describe the household that you grew up in?
My household, so both my parents are from Vietnam. I'm the first child. And then 2 years later, we had a sister, and my grandma on my mom's side also lived with us. So that was my household.
Cool. And are you still like close with your sister today?
Yes. Yeah. So now, then when I was 15, my mom gave birth to another sister. So I wouldn't say I grew up with her, but she is definitely still my sister. So I'm very close to both of my sisters. And yeah.
I see. That's like a pretty big age gap.
Yeah, it's a really big age gap. But I think like once she turned 10, we were able to be friends a little bit more. Like we could discuss books that she and I would both find interesting. And now she's 18 and she actually lives with me in the other apartment bedroom. So we are very close.
That's cool. That sounds like a very solid relationship. So did you grow up speaking Vietnamese with your family?
Yes. So my parents, they were fluent in English. They both actually got their college degrees in America. They didn't come to America to study, but because they were refugees. But once they came over here, they were able to attend school in English. My mom graduated from University of Houston, actually. But my parents just felt like school would teach me English. So they only spoke Vietnamese to me when I was growing up. So until I went to preschool when I was 4, I didn't speak English. But now it's, yeah. But then once I learned English, it was more like my parents would speak Vietnamese to us, sometimes English, and then we would reply back in English. So
I see. Yeah, I kind of have a similar thing with my parents, but like in Chinese. Mm-hmm. Do you have any like favorite memories of your childhood that you'd like to share?
Favorite memories? So something that's great, I think, about being in Texas is, well, not great, but like a consequence of it being so hot is there's so many pools and that's like very readily available. So our backyard had a pool and yeah, and I felt like I spent so many of my summers there with my cousins or with my friends, just like messing around or like making up imaginary games in the pool.
That sounds really fun. Nice. So what were your parents' occupations in Vietnam? And then also, I guess, in the U.S. after?
In Vietnam, so my dad left when he was 18. So he was about to go to college. He managed to like score well enough on the exams to where he didn't have to get drafted. But once he like went to Saigon to get ready to like go to college there, then the fall of Saigon happened. So then he had to leave and go to a refugee camp in Guam before coming over to America. Once he was in America, he was a busboy. But oh yeah, so we're focusing on back in Vietnam. For my mom is 8 years younger than my dad. So she wasn't college age during the fall of Saigon. But because her dad, my grandpa, taught engineering to the Southern Vietnamese Army and the Southern Vietnamese Army lost, they put him in re-education camp. And then they also like took away my family's land. And my mom, like any like family from like that's related to the Southern government wasn't really allowed to study in college unless they like happened to be brilliant. So my mom wasn't allowed to study until she came to America in her early 20s.
I see. And then your parents like met in America?
Yes, my parents met in America. Yeah, they met in Houston.
Oh, nice. So what would you say are some important values or lessons that your parents instilled in you?
Important values or lessons? I would say something they emphasize is a respect of elders. I don't know if it's like a lesson that I really took away. And I don't know if they try to teach this lesson, but a lesson that I did take away, I think it's just like the idea that at any time, like things could happen, and like what you think you have or what you think you are in control of is like can be taken away from you. And then I think with that, I'm just like very, I don't know, cautious or yeah, or just like always like trying to think of backup plans or like just like backup scenarios. And then something else that I also think I learned from them is that like, even if something terrible were to happen and like America were to collapse or whatever, and then like, you know, our banking system doesn't work anymore or whatever, then I can start in a new country because my grandparents and my parents were able to do it. So I know like that even if you throw me in a random country in the future, like I'll be able to make it work.
Yeah, that's really powerful. And so did your parents also tell you like any stories about their immigration process from Vietnam to the US?
Yeah, so my dad, he, his older brother, so my dad is one of 11, like one of the younger ones of 11 children. And so one of his older brothers worked, I think for the Vietnamese Navy or was in the Navy or something and had some connections. So he was able to get out like with a Navy ship and then was picked up by the US ship. And then he was taken to Guam for the refugee camp. But he said he had, and like, when we think of refugee camps, we think of like terrible situations, which I'm sure is terrible for many people. But for him, he like loved it. And I've talked to many like Vietnamese men who were teenagers during their time at the refugee camps. And they like absolutely love their time, like being on an island and having no school, no responsibilities, and just like jumping and playing around. So that's what my dad did when he was there. And then he got sponsored to go to America. And yeah, and then he just talked about like how him and his brothers would try to find work. But then when they went to the restaurant, like they didn't know how to use public transportation. So they were like crossing highways and just like running everywhere in like California. And then the restaurant's like, well, we can't hire you until you learn how to use the buses. Like you're going to die getting over here. So he had to like learn the public transportation system and then like eventually work from that to getting an engineering degree. So it was just like such a whirlwind of experiences.
Yeah, that's super impressive that he was able to do that. That's really cool. So I guess the last question of like your early life before we move on to education. So were there any like traditional Vietnamese holidays or customs that you practiced growing up?
Yeah, for me growing up and still my favorite holiday is Tet or Lunar New Year's. It's very similar to a lot of the Chinese practices in that there's a dragon dance, red lucky envelopes, all of that. And I just loved like, I have a big family. I don't know if I have a big family, but I think like the concept of family is a lot looser to where it's like literally anyone who's related to us within the Houston area will gather. And yeah, and I'll be able to see my cousin, get money, which was always like a thing I enjoyed as a kid, and then do just like very low stakes gambling on playing bokul, like some kind of thing where you just like place your bet on where the die will roll and stuff. So that was always enjoyable. And I love the drums of the lion dances. Like I always get happy when I hear them.
Yeah, that's great. Moving on to college. So you attended UT for undergrad and you studied marketing and psychology. So what first drew you to those two fields and how did they kind of blend together for you?
Yeah, so I went to UT, which was like a controversial decision for my mom because she wanted me to stay close and either go to Rice or go to U of H and then like live at home. And she's like, never leave home until I got married. So like, pushing to go to Austin was like very much pissed her off. But because I had gotten into the business school at UT, which is like a really good school to get into, I felt like I had a strong case to make for why I went to UT. And in the end, like, I ended up getting financial aid, and like I financed the whole thing, so they don't really have a huge say in where I go to college. But initially in the business school, I didn't know what to pick because I didn't know anything about business. I just applied because I thought it sounded impressive. And then so my parents, since they both have computer science backgrounds, that's what they ended up doing in America. They wanted me to go to management information systems, and I did it just to do it for the first couple of years, but I realized the only class at school I didn't fall asleep in was marketing. So that's how I chose my major. And then psychology was another class that I did really well in and definitely didn't fall asleep in. So I wanted to minor in that. And I felt like it worked really well with marketing because we have to think about consumers and their behaviors all the time. So
yeah, there's definitely a lot of similarities between the two. So what were some extracurricular activities, jobs, or clubs that you participated in during college?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I participated in a lot of different ones. I felt like in high school, I had a lot of Asian friends. And so in college, I really wanted to branch out, or like I specifically chose not to join the different Vietnamese or Asian organizations at school, because I wanted to expand the type of friends I gained or like the type of experiences I was exposed to. So one organization I was in was the University Residence Halls Association. I was like the treasurer, and I was able to get free housing for that year. So that was very enjoyable. Because I had majored in management information systems, I was very involved in that organization too, which is like less relevant once I did marketing. But those are like some of the top ones that come to mind.
Cool. And did you like do any food related clubs, or like when did you first get an interest in cooking?
I actually did not become interested in cooking until much later in life. So after I already grad, I was a terrible cook in college, and a lot of my guy friends like would make fun of me for it. And then I think girls are too nice to make fun of me, so that's why I emphasize guy friends. And so it wasn't until I moved to New York after graduating, and I just had to save money because, you know, it was like a starting salary and I was living in Manhattan. So I was just like trying to save money by cooking, which I didn't end up saving that much money, but by doing that, like a lot of my friends and I were cooking and going to each other's places. I felt like, yeah, it just got me really interested in it and really interested in like a lot of the different dietary restrictions. I think New York is a lot more, New York and LA are just like a lot more conscious about dietary restrictions, or they have a lot more, and it's a lot less like meat based than Texas is, which kind of aligns with the types of food I like anyways. So then I think through that, I was able to like really study things and play with levers and like understand why people choose the different diets they do and really just like break down food in that way.
Well, that's so cool. Yeah, I didn't realize it was kind of like something that came later in life for you.
Yeah, yeah, I didn't. My mom is not like a good cook. I never learned from her. So it's a very like different story than a lot of people have about cooking. It was never, it wasn't like I was always interested in it or anything. Like I obviously am interested in like food and eating good food. And I was like, I think even more so in New York, it accelerated. But yeah, but then cooking itself came later.
Yeah, it's really interesting. So in college, what were some like most defining moments in general that you can think back to?
Most defining moments in college? Let's see. Well, on the topic of college and food, I think I had like three dishes that I could make. I made a honey and soy sauce glazed salmon. I made a Cajun like creamy pasta, and then I made naan pizzas. So it was like such a random assortment of food, but those were like the only foods I knew how to make. So yeah, so then a lot of my like food memories are me in my apartment doing that. Something that I think really shaped my college experience was studying abroad. I did it the second semester of my junior year. I went to England, even though that's such like a half step in studying abroad, because we have so much in common in culture, and obviously there's not a huge language barrier or anything, but I think it just opened my eyes up to traveling a lot, because I had like 5-day weekends when I went over there. So I was just constantly traveling, going to different countries, interacting with a lot of the people who were in the study abroad program, who became friends with me. And later on in life, I visited them and everything. But that, I think, was really the start of what became a more international career.
Cool. Are you still in touch with any like friends or professors from either from UT or from studying abroad?
Friends or professors, or just, okay. A lot of my close, a lot of my friends after graduating, we kind of like expanded. A lot of us went to New York, which felt very much like UT part two. And then a lot of us like went to San Francisco as well, or eventually migrated from San Francisco to New York. New York to San Francisco. But now I'm seeing with a lot of my friends that we're slowly coming back. So in the past 2 years or so, my two closest friends from UT have moved back to Austin, which was like a big thing kicking me to want to move to Austin too. So there's that. And then, from study abroad, I think there's still some friends that I have definitely seen, like when I'm there, like during my first trip to Hong Kong, I met up with my Hong Kong friends, or like there's been a couple times where I've gone to the Basque country in northern Spain to see one of my good friends there. But it hasn't been too much lately, because now that I think about it, I'm like, now it's been over 10 years since we've been together. But yeah.
Yeah, that's definitely understandable. And it's cool that people like kind of go to these like same cities, like New York and like San Francisco. Mm-hmm.
It made it very easy to stay in touch, which is why I would say I'm like closer. Well, obviously my college friends, I had been with them for 4 years, but a lot of my college friends were also like from either from like my high school or like the suburb that or from Katy where I grew up or like whatever. And so we just had many more years together, because then we also like were together in New York. Or later on when I moved to Asia, one of my friends was also traveling and living in Asia as well. So we're able to keep it up.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And kind of on the topic of traveling, it seems like you did some really cool traveling after graduating college, like going to New York, Central and South America, Singapore, mm-hmm. and Vietnam. So could you walk us a bit through that post-graduation time period?
Yeah. So post-graduation, there weren't very many companies I wanted to work at full time of the ones that came to recruit Emma Combs. So I looked into being able to intern in London after college. There's like a special visa program. So I did that. And that was when I first worked at a branding agency. And I was like, this is it. This is what I want to do. But I don't want to return to the US quite yet. So then I went to Istanbul and I was an au pair for like 3 months. I hated it. It really like, I was supposed to spend 6 months there, but it really like having to wipe a 4-year-old's butt really made me appreciate working a corporate job. So after that, I found a job in New York at the same branding agency I interned at in London. And actually the agency I work at now is the same agency. I've gone back to them. This is my third time. So then I lived in New York and I worked there for 4 years and hung out with a lot of my college friends. And then I felt like my view of marketing was just like very limited. And I wanted to get a non-Western experience. Like I had the London experience, I had the New York experience, and I wanted something that was a lot more different way of looking at marketing or looking at branding. So I found a job in Singapore, and from Singapore, I could work throughout the Southeast Asian region or even all of Asia. And there's so much diversity. in Southeast Asia in terms, and all of Asia in terms of like language, culture, religion, even the alphabet. Like, it's so much more variety than you would get in Europe or South America. And so, yeah, so I got a job there, but between my New York, Singapore time, I took a break for a few months and I traveled around South America, where I was able to stay with a lot of people that I had done Airbnb hosting in New York. So I was able to stay with a lot of my Airbnb guests and just like, and then meet up with some friends from studying abroad who were Chileans. So lots of connections there. Definitely felt like connected to a lot of people in the world and just like had that personal connection with these different cities. Then when I was in Singapore, my job took me all over Asia. I was traveling probably 2 weeks out of the month. Singapore is so small and flights are so cheap. That's what most of us ended up doing. So I rarely spent any time in Singapore. Yeah, went around Southeast Asia. I would say my favorite places were Bali and Vietnam. I loved Vietnam so much. Obviously there's that cultural connection, but also like, I think objectively the food is like just very good. And the people are very nice. Not that they're not nice everywhere else, but it just, yeah, was like extra special for me. I was sent to work there a lot as well. So then after a year and a half or so of living in Singapore, I realized I was like not very happy in Singapore, and I was much, much happier in Vietnam. So I moved there, found a job there in Vietnam. And then all of a sudden my exploration turned inwards, more towards Vietnam or more towards staying in Saigon. I was so much happier like being in one place versus Singapore, where I always wanted to leave. And in Vietnam, I worked at another branding agency, but on the side, I started cooking and hosting these dinners in my apartment, doing Vietnamese Mexican food. And then that just took off. So then I quit my job and concentrated on that for a while. And then after 2 years in Vietnam, almost 4 years in Asia, I went back to Houston. Because of, I had like a health issue. So I needed to go back to get American healthcare, and then also to get, to have my parents be able to take care of me. So I was in Houston for about like 2.5 years or so before moving to Austin 1 month ago.
That's a ton of moving around, but it sounds like you had a lot of like personal growth moments like all around the world. That's really cool. Mm-hmm. So correct me if I'm wrong, are you currently like a brand strategist?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Could you kind of take us through a day in your life?
Yeah. So I work remotely. So right now I'm in the Chicago office of Landor and Fitch. I've worked in their London office, like I said, and their New York office, but now I'm with their Chicago office. And and I have clients like Coca-Cola or Procter & Gamble. So like very big brands, which is always like, yeah, big brands is always very interesting. I like working on small brands, but there's different challenges that come with larger brands. So I will, let's see. So even though I'm working remotely, I'm still trying to like draw clear lines of delineation between when I work or like when I'm at home and when I work. So my boyfriend and I will take these like walks to work for like 15 minutes around the area, just to feel like, okay, this is the difference. And then at work, I don't know how to describe it. So I'll say a brand strategist is someone who, you know how like designers create packaging design and logo designs and things like that. And so as a brand strategist, we come before the design phase, we define what the brand is and what it stands for. And then we help give the designers territories or directions that they can then design off of to help them be more creative. Because I know I hate it when I'm just given a blank piece of paper and it's like, oh, do whatever you want, like make, cook whatever you want, whatever it is, the prompt, the like that actually hinders my creativity. Whereas like when you put constraints on it, like in New York, when I had the constraints of like, oh, I have to cook gluten-free or whatever, or vegan or whatever the situation is, it allows me to be a lot more creative once that's channeled. So that's like the role of the strategist. We just help clarify things, or we just help point things in a specific direction, whether it's like our client or them. But yeah, it comes out as PowerPoints. I would say that's mostly what I am producing, PowerPoints, words and PowerPoints. And yeah, and then I do that from 8 until like 4:30 or so. And then I stop. And so far it's been a lot of moving, like moving related stuff in Austin, or because now I have such a big social network here since so many of my friends ended up moving to Austin. Yeah, just spending time with them, which, you know, I haven't been able to because of the pandemic, but also like being in Houston, there were just like a lot, surprisingly, even though I grew up there, there were just like a lot less people I knew there versus in some other cities.
That's great. It sounds like this is like really the spot for you. Mm-hmm. So like as a brand strategist, it seems like it's a very like people person field where you have to interact closely with your clients. So what's your favorite part of working closely with your clients, and then also the most challenging part?
For me, I actually, so there are people who do client services, and so they have to work with their clients a lot. And I've done client services before as well. And I would say when I was in that role, the most challenging thing is it feels like you're just constantly putting out fires or responding to like time-based things. Like there's so many reactionary parts to the job. Whereas as a strategist, yes, there's a lot of internal meetings that I'm attending more. But then I'm able to like spend time and do work without having to, you know, like deal with every client request or whatever that comes up. But I would say as a strategist, the most difficult thing is, the best thing is when you have a client who really trusts you as a partner, or can just like, doesn't like nitpick the details, but can see like the bigger picture of where things are going, versus being like, oh, we would never like say that or use that or whatever it is. The challenging thing is when there's very little consumer data. Like I remember in Vietnam, I was working with some energy drink, and it sounded like their target audience was like people 18 to 45 who get thirsty. Like it was just something like that, where I'm like, how can I, like I said, like I need to have constraints in order to be creative. So it's like, how can I work with that? You know, like where does that take me? Literally anyone with a mouth. Okay, great.
Yeah, that sounds like a pretty challenging thing to work on. So I guess reflecting on your experiences growing up in the US and then venturing into like a wide range of opportunities and work environments over the course of your life, what do you think is the key to success for younger generation Asian Americans, or like any pieces of advice you would give?
Yeah, I would say the key to success, or something that I wish I did more or am trying to do more, it's just like owning your Asian Americanness. Like I feel like, or at least maybe it's been my experience and I'm just projecting, there's so much like just fitting in, or like, you know, like how you hear in some places, like they don't want to like consider us like minorities for things. And like, I just feel like a lot of times people forget, like your coworkers forget how different you are, or like, you know, how your point of view isn't necessarily like theirs. And yeah, and then so I would say, like, I would hope with this future generation that people just like speak out more, or like are more proud of like where they're from, or just like, I don't know, bring it up more instead of trying to hide it.
Yeah, I think that totally makes sense. Thank you for sharing. So I guess moving on to Saigonita. So I read how it combines Vietnamese cuisine with Mexican cuisine, and I thought that was a pretty unique fusion. So how did you kind of come up with that idea? And are you still like actively opening Saigonita now? Or I guess you did it in Vietnam, but are you thinking of doing it in also here?
I just did it in Vietnam. Oh. Yeah. So I came up with that idea because, growing up in Texas, I ate a lot of Mexican food, and it's definitely one of my favorite cuisines, but it's like how I describe other cuisines, are like, for those who aren't familiar with Vietnamese food, I'll just like use like Mexican like terms, like for bayum yum, which is like this beef that you dip in vinegar and then you roll your own rice paper. I'm like, oh, it's kind of like fajitas, where, you know, you have to like do it on your own and add all these extra things inside. And then I think I did it enough times to where I'm like, oh, I think there are a lot of similarities. And then like in ingredients to like the limes, the cilantro, things like that. And so to me, it felt like they really naturally fit together, but I saw a lot of like Korean Mexican fusion, which I also love and is delicious. But I remember seeing a Korean Mexican place open up in Vietnam, and I was like, what the heck, we're in Vietnam. If like a Mexican Vietnamese fusion were to happen anywhere, it should happen here. I can't believe no one's doing it. I've waited for so long, just like I've waited for non-pizzas to be a business for so long. Like, I just want to do it on my own. So then I just like, I felt like it naturally fit together. No one was doing it. I compared to other people in Vietnam, I felt like I had like a very deep knowledge of Mexican food. I mean, there were Mexicans in Vietnam, of course, and there were like, and there were other Mexican restaurants in Vietnam, but a lot of them were created by, a lot of the other Mexican restaurants were created by people who were either from Mexico or from America or whatever. But I'm like, okay, I also have that deep knowledge of Vietnamese food, and like deep in the way where you just like, when you grow up with a type of cuisine, you just like know it in that way. And then, so I felt like, okay, I'm at a very unique space in Vietnam where I have a deep knowledge of both these foods. I wouldn't say the same as like, I wouldn't say I would be as rare in Houston. I think there's plenty of people in Houston who have a deep knowledge of both those cuisines. But in Vietnam, I was like, that was the thing that made me like more rare or stand out. So then, I felt like it could be a thing. And my friends and I were just messing around with it. I had a Vietnamese Czech friend, and he wanted us to enter this like taco festival. And he's like, oh yeah, you always told me about your like Vietnamese Mexican food idea, because I say it hoping that someone will overhear it and do it themselves. But then he was just like, oh, you want to do it? And I was like, okay, sure, let's try it. And yeah, and then it ended up working out really well.
Yeah, good for you for taking that plunge. I remember there's a food truck, I think, in Houston. I forget the name, but it's like Korean Mexican fusion. So I think that's like definitely more popular or like more common, but yeah, yours is the first I've heard with Vietnamese and Mexican.
I think there's like maybe one or two things going on in California, but it's definitely more rare.
Yeah, for sure. So like logistically for Saigonita, was it like closed door, or like, was it open to the public, or was it like invite only or word of
mouth? So how I did it was I could seat, because I had these special tables made, so I could seat 14 guests. So I would open it up to like hey, there's 14 spots, like just like sign up or ping me to sign up or like whatever it is, like once you put in your deposit, you're in here. And then whoever didn't get in, I would just put on like a wait list for next time. So then for the next dinner, I would message them first, give them like a, you know, few hours or one day advance, like sale or whatever. And do it that way. So it was kind of public, but very limited in scope. because I could only physically fit so many people. But there were a lot of people that I did not know how they heard of it or how they came there. And like, and there were plenty of people who read about it in like Vice or different articles. And so they were visiting Vietnam. So I've had people, yeah, visiting from America or visiting from Singapore, like whatever, who had read about it and wanted to come.
That's really cool. Did it, like, did the list fill up pretty quickly?
Yeah. It's usually within a day. Yeah. Cool. By the end of the day, I'll have it filled. And then, yeah, and then I can be happy and know that, okay, I can buy my ingredients now.
So I know you mentioned your Vietnamese Czech friend. Did they work with you on that? Or like how many people were on your team, I guess?
Yeah. So he worked with me. My team was it rotated a lot. There was always two other people helping me out. Someone would act as like my sous chef, and then someone would act as my bartender, and we were all the waiters and the dishwashers. So it was like a lean, like it's crazy what you can accomplish with just like three people. Cause we had a 7-course meal and 3 drinks, 3 like accompanying like cocktails or whatever. So, yeah, so it was a lot. And yeah, in the beginning, it was my Vietnamese Czech friend, but he had no knowledge of Mexican food, so he was rolled off eventually. Then I had a friend who was from Houston who I met in Vietnam, but she's Cantonese, and she helped me, but she was not a professional chef in any way. So she knew Mexican food, but rolled off because cooking-wise, it was like just like very slow. And then and then another friend was my bartender, like one of the guests from the first dinner wanted to be my bartender. And so then that was like my initial like scrappy team. And then it just like, then I could advance to it. Then eventually like it became established enough to where I could advance to another level where I ended up working with this Vietnamese chef. He was actually on MasterChef Vietnam, like season 1 or 2 or something like that. And he came in second place when he was in college, and he just like dropped out of college to like cook full time. I loved working with him. He really like leveled up the cooking that we did there. And so he brought in that experience. I brought in the Mexican, like the Mexican food knowledge and ability to cook that. And he brought in the ability to cook Vietnamese food and just like general like technique. And then the bartender I had was actually my friend owned a coffee shop, and his barista was interested in bartending as well. And then so I hired him, and he was just like fantastic. And so when the three of us got together, it was just like we worked so smoothly, and things like just went super, super well.
Very cool. That sounds like a dream team.
Yeah. And the barista was also Vietnamese. So that's also what I enjoyed doing, that I was working with Vietnamese people and then like employing them. And then also like definitely having people around that I could ask about Vietnamese food.
Yeah, for sure. So what are some examples of dishes that you would serve?
So big dish we would serve was the Hue-vos Rancheros, which is a play on word because Hue is the imperial city of Vietnam. It's where my ancestors are from. And it's like what Bún bò Hue is named after, that beef noodle dish. So in our Hue-vos Rancheros, we have like the tostada base of Hue-vos Rancheros and like that salsa and the fried egg. But we would use our meat, like the bún bò Hue, lemongrass, like spicy beef in a braised way. So it kind of like pulls apart. And then instead of like a fried chicken egg, we would have fried little quail eggs on top, or like a little fried quail egg, as well as Vietnamese satay, which is sometimes added to bún bò Hue. So we added that. And yeah, it was just like really fun to try to balance the different elements of Vietnamese and Mexican food and add something new to it, but then also like stay true to some of the dish's roots.
Yeah, that sounds really amazing. You're making my mouth water. So I guess another question is, like, what was your favorite memory or aspect of Saigonita now that I guess it's closed?
Mm-hmm. I would say my favorite memories are, and this would be like a little more, I'll name this maybe specifically. Maybe it's like top of mind because it was like the last experience, but towards the end, our last two dinners, I knew I was moving to America, or no, I had been offered a job like in Vietnam as like a head chef of another restaurant. And so I knew Saigonita was ending. And so I wanted to do something big for its ending. So I rented out this event space from like a friend of a friend. And then working with that Vietnamese family there. And in the event space, it was enough room for 40 people, which is like crazy to go from 14 to 40 people. And it was crazy because the first dinner was like a disaster. Like, it was just, oh wow, you know, it's like a new building or a new area. So we didn't know the acoustics are terrible when you put 40 people in there. I was trying to cook and I had to be like hostess and oversee everything. So then it obviously wasn't work, or no, I was hostess. I was like being a waitress and then also trying to oversee things. And then also like checking in on the kitchen. And so it was like a disaster. And then the food was just like served in a weird order. So then like people were like, oh, should I wait for the whole table to like have food before I eat? And then they would, and then their food would go cold by then. And just like 1,000 mistakes were made. And I felt like it was bad. I think a lot of people had a great time, but to me, it wasn't like the level that I wanted to be at. So the next day I sent out surveys to all the guests, and then of the ones who answered, it was painful to read, but all the ones that answered, I would read their different criticisms. And then after that, I went and I brainstormed with someone on my team. And then like, I had to let go of some new team members where it just like wasn't working out, and like try to figure out how can I improve this within 24 hours? Because the next day I had my second dinner there. And yeah, and then so it was just like a scramble coming up with an action plan, hiring new people, hiring new wait staff and like new kitchen help and everything, and just like turning it around. And that last dinner, I felt like it just went really well and I could really like enjoy myself. I didn't give myself the task of being waitress or being a cook. I could just like manage the whole experience and interact with my guests. And yeah, and then afterwards, so many of us like stayed later and just like watched music videos on the giant screens and hung out and stuff. And that's what I really enjoy, that feeling of community and knowing like so many people have like met through my dinners. I met my roommate in Vietnam through one of my dinners, and yeah, that connection. And I just felt like, okay, I was able to like have this impact on Vietnam in some way, like have an impact on the people I worked with at these different dinners, or introduce people to the venue, things like that.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, food is an amazing way to bring people together. I'm sure like a lot of people met each other for the first time. So is your family still in the US, and have you cooked for them recently? And if so, what were their reactions?
Yes, my family is still in the US. My immediate family was all in Houston until my sister and I recently moved to Austin. All in Katy. We were all in under one roof for the past couple of years. So very close. I cooked for them. I don't cook for them too often because everyone has different tastes. Like, my youngest sister is very picky. My parents only like to eat Vietnamese food. And so it's just like, it becomes very hard or very limiting. I don't enjoy cooking Vietnamese food when it's for my mom, just because sometimes she'll have comments and stuff like that. There have been things that have been well received by them that were Vietnamese, but or not. But yeah, in general, I think if I cook more Western dishes, I'm more likely to have a better reaction. I can't remember the last time I cooked for them though, because I really do not enjoy doing it.
I see. That's valid. Yeah. I guess, could you imagine ever opening something similar to Saigonita in the US? Or do you think, like, could you imagine like other people maybe doing that?
Yeah, I have thought about it a lot. And at one point when I returned to Houston, I had started at another agency and then I quit. And I was thinking of opening up a fast casual chain doing vegetarian Vietnamese food. And I had developed the menu and everything and done recipe testing and looked at sites and did like the financial projections and everything. And it just like really didn't make sense. It didn't make sense in terms like as a business, because the first couple of years I would have to work every day and never have a sick day and never take a vacation. And my health issue was that I had to get a liver transplant. And so like post-transplant, I was like, that's not possible. I have to go to the doctors all the time. I am like, I physically cannot do that much. Like being a cook is very physically challenging and I cannot physically do that as a post-transplant patient. I mean, some post-transplant patients can, but like a new post-transplant patient. And so then that I was just like, okay, it doesn't make sense. And I've thought of it on smaller scales, because the problem with Saigonita was I could never think of how do I scale this in a way where I can just do this full time. And it's like, I would obviously have to hold more dinners or whatever. And it's like, okay, well, I don't want to live in a restaurant. Like, I don't want to like live where I work. And then if I rent a place, it's so expensive. So there's a lot of considerations. And in the US, they're like more picky about like having health licenses or like food and cooking licenses and stuff like that. Whereas in Vietnam, it was like more laissez-faire, or I knew like, oh, okay, my cooking sanitary practices is way more sanitary than a lot of the street food vendors. So I'm good. Whereas like in the US, there's a lot more restrictions on it. So yes, I thought about it. No, I have not come up with a good way to do it though.
Yeah, it sounds like there's a lot of like logistical complications that go into it.
Mm-hmm.
So moving on a bit to your identity. So you mentioned on the Vietnam podcast that you identify as Viet Q, which like broadly speaking is any Vietnamese person living overseas, even though there are like other various definitions. Mm-hmm. So would you like to elaborate on that? And do you still identify that way?
Yeah, I identify less that way because now I'm in America, so it's less of a term, like whereas like Vietnamese American is more of a term. So here Vietnamese American feels appropriate, but there I felt like Vietnamese American would have been too limiting. Like if those were the people I really connected to and related to, it would have been, there were plenty in Vietnam, but it would have been a lot more limiting. Whereas in Vietnam, I felt like anyone who grew up either in Europe or the Americas or Canada or whatever, but who was ethnically Vietnamese, we had so, and living in, and currently living in Vietnam, I felt like we had so much in common and that was like, yeah, just like having that in common automatically allows you to relate to someone and be able to like befriend someone off of that. And then here, I don't know, I don't relate to everyone who is like ethnically Vietnamese in Texas, so then there's a lot more of a disconnect here.
I see. Yeah, and I guess the way you identify yourself can also be pretty fluid as time changes. And it's also kind of interesting that you like reverse migrated to Vietnam. Since you, before you came to Austin, I mean, like you returned to the country that your parents immigrated from. So have they ever like told you anything how like they feel about this?
Yeah, my parents were not happy that I was doing this. They wanted me to stay in Singapore. They were very happy with the move to Singapore, much happier than my move to New York. And so I don't know what the fascination was with Singapore. It was just some old holdout from Singapore's reputation as like a rich, nice country compared to Vietnam. So they were upset about it, but I felt like they don't understand. And a lot of the older Vietnamese who immigrated over in the 70s or 80s and haven't been back to Vietnam in a long time don't know how much Vietnam has changed, and they don't realize like how good life there can be. Like, I remember it was Thanksgiving and I was preparing a Thanksgiving dinner for my friends, and my mom's like, you can get turkey in Vietnam. And I was like, yes, you can literally get anything if you have enough money. Like, it's just like, it's fine. Like, things are different. Like, it's the apartment I lived in there is probably going to be the nicest apartment I live in my whole life. You know, like, it's just like, it's not the Vietnam that they remember, which is great. I really wanted to make my own memories with it in Vietnam and have my own relationship with Vietnam and not have it just be something that is filtered through my refugee parents who left in their like early years.
Yeah, for sure. And kind of like related to that, like looking back on your own experiences as a child of immigrant parents, what would be your advice to current immigrant parents?
Oh, to current parents who are immigrants and raising their kid in America? That's hard because I've never been able to see it from their point of view. It feels like such a huge chasm. I would say, I don't know if they would like take this seriously, but I think it's just like accepting that your child is going to grow up differently than you did. And that's the reason you immigrated over here. Like, just like letting go and not trying not to compare them to like, oh, like a child in Vietnam would never do this. Like, if you were in Vietnam and you had handwriting like this, you would be slapped till your hands are red or like whatever. And it's just like, okay, well, we're not in Vietnam. You came to America for a reason. I mean, I guess they were, since my parents were refugees, it was more like they were forced over. But like, if someone were to willingly immigrate to America with the hopes of raising their children there, they are doing it like for a reason, like in hopes that their child will have this like American way of life or education. And I think you have to accept the cons that come with that, if you're going to accept the pros that come with it.
Yeah, I think that's a solid piece of advice. I think probably a lot of people resonate with that as well. So switching gears a little, as you mentioned, and like also I read a little bit about your liver transplant on your Instagram. Would you feel comfortable like sharing the amazing story behind it?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, so I live near a train station. So I found out I needed a liver transplant back when I was 22, working my first job in New York. And that was like almost 10 years ago. Well, it's 10 years ago now, but I had gone in for a routine checkup. My blood work was off. Then they like looked into it more and they found, they realized that, when I was a baby, I didn't have bile ducts and I had a surgery for it. And I thought, and my parents thought that's the end of that, we're done. But apparently, it's not the end of that. It's like a temporary bandage on the problem, with transplant being like the option that usually comes later. And so I was just like very fortunate that I didn't need a transplant as a child, which most people do as a baby or a child with my condition. And so my doctors were very vague. They were just like, at first I thought I needed it that summer, but then they were like, oh, actually you're doing fine. We don't know when you'll need a transplant. It might be next year. It might be in 10 years. So just keep doing blood work, or like, just like keep us posted, or like whatever, keep going to regular checkups. And so I was doing, so I would do blood work like once a month. Every time I moved, I would have to find a new doctor and make sure that, you know, I was getting labs done or following up with like a liver specialist in Singapore and in Vietnam. And so in Vietnam, it got to a level to where my liver doctor there was like, hey, it's getting worse. You're probably going to need a transplant soonish in the next couple of years. And in Vietnam, we've only done one liver transplant before ever. And the doctor was from Korea. So I recommend you go to America and like get it done there. And then, so I was like, yeah, definitely. I don't want to be number two. This, you know, like I want to be number like 2000 or whatever. And then, yeah. And then, so when I got back, yeah. So when I came back to Houston, there was only one hospital, Houston Methodist, that had the certification to do a living donor liver transplant, where you can get it, where someone who is alive can donate half their liver to you. And then their half will grow back in them. Their half in you will grow back as well. And then that way you don't have to wait for an organ to come onto the market, which is great because you can actually plan your transplant. It's not like I'm waiting on the phone for the chance that someone in my, like, you know, within 100, 200 miles of me who has the same size liver as I have will, but who is healthy, will like die and also be signed up to be an organ donor. And like, you know, like it's just like so rare for all those things to come together. And I would probably be like really sick by the time I can move up the transplant list enough to like get one of those organs. So I wanted to do it through living donor instead. And at Methodist Hospital, they had actually never done a living donor liver transplant before. So I was actually going to be number one, or actually ended up being number one, which is funny because I left Vietnam because I didn't want to be number two. So originally I thought my sister is going to be my donor, the sister who's 2 years younger than me, who's really close with me. Because when I was in New York, she was evaluated to be my donor. Everything looked good. And the evaluation process is a lot of like health checks and like looking at the liver and the size and everything. But suddenly she like wasn't, or like the hospital didn't accept her as my donor and it wasn't going to work out. So I was really like panicked and stressed because I didn't know who else could be my donor. Like I said, I didn't have like a huge network within Houston. My parents were too old to be my donor. My youngest sister was like a minor. She had no interest in being my donor. And so I just like didn't know where to look or where to go. So I just like posted about it on Instagram, like just like that I was like upset with the situation. It's not like I wanted anyone to do anything, but just to express like, hey, today sucks because this happened. And a lot of my friends were asking like, how can I help? And I was like, okay, well, maybe we can like spread the word that I need a donor, because I've heard of that happening, you know, in other places where a stranger will donate. And then it was crazy. So many people came through. People are so good. Like 3 or 4 strangers in Houston, like just reached out to me. I don't even know, like, you know, like what their, a lot of their connection to my post was, but it had spread. But one of the people who came through was a friend of mine from high school, Anne Le, and we're actually like very distantly related. And we weren't that close in high school, but we stayed in touch through Instagram. And we had met up when she was visiting Vietnam. And yeah, and then so she was the only one of the people who volunteered that who was someone I actually knew. Even though she was living in Austin, I thought like, okay, let's try this. Like, let's try to go with her just so it's better with someone I know versus like a stranger. And yeah, it ended up working out. She donated her liver to me. She underwent a huge surgery to go from like a healthy person with a full liver to having half a liver. And now we're super close. The other day I was at a pool party at her place. So yeah, good. Now I have like a lifelong friend from the process.
Yeah, that's so amazing and inspiring. And I really love how like so many people like were so willing to help. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I guess like moving on to more like fun questions. Mm-hmm. If you were stranded on a desert island and you could only make one recipe for the rest of your life, what would you choose?
If I could only make one recipe, I always when I think of like, oh, you can only have one food for the rest of your life, I always think salad, but I'm like, oh, I know that's cheating because, you know, you would just like change the salad. But if I had to make one recipe, I don't know. Oh, I know. I would make gyozas, like pork and chive gyozas with like a soy sauce, or like with a great dipping sauce that's like soy sauce, sesame oil, black vinegar, chili crunch, and like, yeah, it just has like all these elements and I could eat it all day. And I know that's not like a practical thing because I would probably die of thirst on this island very quickly, but yeah, that's something that I would be very happy to eat for every meal for a very long time.
That's cool. Yeah, I actually just made like frozen gyoza.
Oh, nice.
But that's very, very different.
Oh, frozen gyozas are very good too. I had them the other day. My boyfriend's more of the gyoza maker, so when it was like my week to cook, I was like, okay, I'll just buy some frozen ones.
Yeah. Yeah. Also, like, what are some of your current like hobbies and interests, like outside of your career?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I try to practice a little bit of yoga every day. And last week I went to my first like in-person yoga class since my transplant. Cause I've been trying to like work up to the stamina. And so I was like super happy. I was able to kind of like keep up, but it definitely kicked my butt. I was sore for like 3 days afterwards. So that was not great, but you know, I'm still gonna keep doing it. And hopefully my strength will build up or my endurance will build up over time. I've also recently I've been into painting since high school, but it's been like watercolor painting, but it's been like in and out. And so I have this one watercolor of poppies that I had taken a picture of in California that I really need to finish, but I think it'll be my best one yet. So it's well worth the 2 months or however long I've been spending painting it bit by bit.
That's awesome. I'm sure it's turned out very beautiful. Yeah, so how often do you go back to visit Vietnam, and are you planning any upcoming trips there?
Yeah, so I left Vietnam right before the pandemic, and then and my thing has been like, oh, I want to return as soon as possible. And then I didn't even realize how possible it was until my dad took a trip. Like my dad recently went to Vietnam for like a month, and I was like, oh, that was an option. How did I miss that as an option? So hopefully this winter I can return, hopefully.
Yeah, fingers crossed. That's pretty exciting. Yeah.
But I would want to return like once every, I mean, in an ideal world, once a year or something, spending months there. But in a realistic world, maybe like once every 2 years or so.
I see. And for my last question, if you could go back in time and give a piece of advice to your younger self, what would you say?
With my younger self, I think I would say to, yeah, I was thinking about this recently where I'm like, okay, I'm imagining my younger self as an elementary school child. And I was like, I feel like elementary school children care about so little in life. And so for me, I think I would, if I were to like meet up with 10-year-old me, I would tell her that, so I hated junior high, it was a terrible experience. I would just tell her that, hey, like the next 3 years or next 2 years are gonna suck a lot, or you're gonna be like very self-conscious, or you're gonna like, you know, like wanna be away from everyone and angry and slam doors and stuff like that. And that's totally normal and it will pass and you will feel better and it will be fine, but just brace yourself for these next couple of years and then eighth grade will happen and it will be good again.
Yeah, that's awesome. So yeah, that's pretty much all the questions that I had planned, but do you have any like anything that you'd like to add?
Nope, I think you covered such a wide range. Thank you so much, Emily.
No problem. Thank you so much for this interview and for sharing your experiences with me, and I wish you a full and speedy recovery. And best of luck with your yoga and your painting as well.
Thank you. All right. Bye.
Bye.